It's a big job just getting by with nine kids and a wife. But I've been working, man, dang near all my life, and I'll keep on working. Long as my two hands are fit to use. I'll drink my beer in a tavern, sing a little bit of these working man blues.
The working people in this country, I think, have supported Merle Haggard. And I was probably 10 number one songs into my career before I realized just how much they were really supporters.
By the late 1950s, honky-tonk music was country's dominant style, and it continued to thrive in the 1960s, thanks to performers like George Jones, Charlie Pride, Buck Owens, and the legendary Merle Haggard.
I think Merle Haggard is a consummate artist and musician. It's about music. It's not about the music business. When a lot of us roosters get thinking we're something after 8 or 9 top 10 records, we should all look over our shoulder and bow to Mr. Haggard.
From a Dust Bowl background and San Quentin prison before age 21, Merle Haggard rose to become the man behind 102 country hits between 1963 and 1990.
There was never a voice like that. That was so much feeling, I think. It was just, he had the whole package. Even had the name. Merle Haggard is a great country name. That's a country star.
My favorite has always been Merle Haggard as a singer. He's got that pure, you know, kind of unpushed natural vocal delivery that's true to a lot of great country singers.
Don't leave me, I cry. Don't take that airplane ride. But you locked me out of your mind and left me standing here behind. Silver wings.
Haggard was such a big influence on my vocal style, and I think you can hear him in so many of us today. It's great to see him finally get some of the recognition that he deserves.
I have a little list here of...
There's something emotional about country music. Or at least there was. I'm a little worried about that part of country music. I don't hear enough emotion. I hear a lot of people in tune, and I hear a lot of perfect records, but I don't hear a lot of emotion. I wish we could get a little more emotion back in it. But what was your question again?
In Merle's book, Sing Me Back Home, he used to hobo, you know, jump on trains to go see Lefty Frizzell. So I got this big idea. Well, I'm young, I want to go on a big adventure. I'm going to go out to California and meet Merle Haggard, you know, and tell him I'm a singer. Maybe he'll help discover me, you know. I snuck on the train, and the train took off, and I had this big lump in my throat, you know. I'm off to California. I'm going. The freight train went 3 miles to the other side of the town and unloaded their lumber, and then 3 miles back to the other side of town. And that freight trains, they don't go cross country anymore. I didn't know that. And that, I told Haggard that story when I got a chance to work with him this year, and I'd never seen him laugh so hard.
Taking you away, leaving me lonely, silver wing, slowly fading out of sight, slowly fading out of sight.
The music I was first around was always acoustic music. Right about in the mid-40s, I began to see and hear an electric guitar. You know, it had this bite to it, and I really think that that's what I liked. I liked that so much.
Thank you.
bright lights you found. There ain't no way to slow you down. Yes, and I'm about as helpless as a leaf in a gale, and it looks like I've got a tiger by the tail.
Buck Owens was one of the most influential, you know, artists of our time, and how he purposely mixed the guitar up real tinny sounding and real high to make it jump off the radio.
Both Buck Owens and Merle Haggard worked out of the Central California agricultural basin. Their success was so overwhelming that people began referring to them as the core of the Bakersfield sound, a rival to the Nashville music business of the 1960s.
There was a refreshing sound from the West Coast, and I think it was brighter and maybe happier. The Nashville sound had a lot of bottom to it, a lot of bass. And then if you put on Tiger by the Tail, it doesn't sound like it has any bass at all, but it cut through like a knife on the radio. In other words, it was a great car radio record.
I've got a tiger by the tail.
AM radio, you know, it was such a terrible system for playing music. The bass would just rumble over everything. So I cut down on the bass and cut up on the high end, and a lot of the guys in those days did too.
The Bakersfield sound, it was just a bunch of really good studio musicians. There was a lot of country talent in Bakersfield, because whenever they migrated out there from Oklahoma and Texas and places like that, they landed in Bakersfield.
No more loneliness, only happiness. Let's go.
I think one of the most exciting sounds in music is Buck Owens, those records that he made in Bakersfield, when he was recording with Don Rich on lead guitar and the harmony singing. I mean, it's so exciting. I'd put it up against just about anything.
I hear bells ringing, birds are singing, love's gonna live here again. And I hear bees are humming, well I know the days are coming. Love's gonna live here again.
The only way that I can describe what I call real country music, honky-tonk music, go get you some old George Jones records from the 50s on up to now, and the Merle Haggard stuff from the 60s. That, to me, is real country music.